Welcome to Young Tuition, a unique channel to explore, study, and share the basic issues in physics and beyond. The model used to predict the global warming is called the greenhouse effect, in which carbon dioxide is considered as a key greenhouse gas. Although there is no roof in such a greenhouse in the atmosphere, to demonstrate this basic idea, many fast food experiments have been published to feed the hungry public, children in particular.
The bottles are like our atmosphere. The lamps are like our sun.
Hot here.
It is indeed. We've kept the two bottles in front of the sun lamps for about 5 minutes.
Today, I'm going to evaluate those experiments in relation to their communication objective and the underlying physics. Enjoy it. This plastic bottle is sealed, but this one contains some water before it was sealed. Now, I put them under the sun. They become two tiny greenhouses. After a while, say 1 hour, the temperature inside the two bottles will increase due to the absence of convection. This is called the greenhouse effect. If you are careful, you may argue that the humidity or the amount of water vapor inside the bottle with water would increase because the water is also getting warmed. Indeed, you are right. Now imagine, if both bottles were filled with CO2 gas before they were sealed, which internal temperature would increase faster? Bear in mind, both CO2 and water vapor are good heat absorbers of infrared radiation, as shown in this earliest experimental result by Rubens and Aschkinass. Furthermore, as you can see, water vapor can absorb much more infrared radiation than the carbon dioxide gas. Therefore, the answer to the question depends on the relative concentrations of those two greenhouse gases. Let's show the first experiment, which was especially designed for American school children by Noah. No, not the Noah in the Bible, but the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, as famous as NASA.
And you know, they will effervesce and they will... Okay, hopefully you can see that. Now I'm gonna put the stopper on here, and I'm gonna stick my temperature probe. Okay, tight. And now I'm gonna turn the lamp on. And I am going to observe the temperature for an hour. I'll just come back in an hour. I will shut this video off and turn it back on, and we'll see what the effect of the temperature of the gas in each bottle is. Stay tuned. My temperature change for the approximately 40 centimeters that I had from this light bulb to these bottles was 9 degrees Celsius, warmer in the bottle with the CO2. Obviously, the carbon dioxide is having an effect.
It is clear that the two final temperatures are apparently different. One is 35.1, another is 44. But wait a moment, which is which? Let's repeat. Here, can you see? The initial temperature inside the bottle without CO2 was 19.8 degrees Celsius.
Okay,
once the lamp was on, the temperature in the red color jumped to 20.5, while the reference temperature to 20.2. After being heated by the lamp, the reference temperature is nearly 10 degrees higher than the temperature inside the bottle with the CO2. Obviously, this experiment failed to demonstrate CO2 can cause the warming faster. This seemingly unexpected result can be explained based on our analysis above. the absorption by CO2 was beaten by the water vapor generated inside the reference bottle. Next, a presenter invited a little boy to talk about the greenhouse effect, but it seems the boy barely knew the word effect.
What are we studying? Because when I walked up to you, you said, would you like to learn about the, and what did you tell me?
Greenhouse effect.
Yeah, look at this one, the green forest. Oh, there it is. It says, if I can read it correctly, 71 degrees. Very, very nice. Then if you pan over here to the control, which is the middle one here, what temperature is that one? A little hard to read because it's kind of foggy, isn't it? It's a little foggy here. Hold on a second. I'm going to turn it around so I can take a look at it. It is 79 degrees.
Oh.
So that's what this one is. The control temperature reading over here on the one with the carbon dioxide. Can we see it? Want to turn it and take a look?
79.
Did you hear what the boy said? Both the temperature in the two sealed jars were identical. 79 degrees, presumably Fahrenheit.
I can tell you a little bit earlier, this one was at 81, this one was at about 79, and see how cool this
was. Did you hear that? The presenter tried to mock up the embarrassment.
Thank you. That is a fascinating, no wonder Steve loved it so much.
Isn't that amazing? This one over here, lowest
amazing.
Temperature.
Do you really want to know why? Because the radiation of the lamp was partially blocked by the plants inside the bottle. That's why its final temperature is the lowest. Next, another science show for children, as the climate reporters in Asia don't want to be left behind.
In the second bottle, add 2 tablespoons of baking soda,
2,
and 60 ml of vinegar. The reaction between vinegar and baking soda results in the production of carbon dioxide. We've kept the 2 bottle in front of the sun lamps for about 5 minutes.
This one is 35, this one is 28.
So the bottle with carbon dioxide is showing a higher temperature as compared to the one with just air.
I don't think so. The important heat absorber from the lamp in this case was water inside the bottle. Because after all, over 95% of vinegar is water. She could simply put the same amount of vinegar into both bottles to see my point. So it is not surprising at all. The absorption by the dry air in this experiment was slower than that by the mixture of CO2 and water vapor. Does that make sense? Next, a public experimental demonstration was presented by Royal Society of Chemistry in London.
Flasks here. One of these, the red one, we've added some carbon dioxide to. The blue one is just air. And we're recording the temperature inside here. You can see it's gradually changing here as I speak. They're getting new data points. But notice that the red one is heating up faster than the blue one. And this is because the carbon dioxide is absorbing some of this energy.
Sounds reasonable. However, this claim only makes sense when the time is less than a few minutes. As the time becomes longer than, say, 4 minutes, as you can see, these two asymptotes, straight line, are almost parallel, which implies the internal temperatures of the two flux increase at the same rate. To help you to understand my explanation, a simple two-component model was built based on their experimental data. One is a linear function that represent the heat transfer from the heated flux. Another is an exponential function describing the heat absorption at the earliest stage. Indeed, concentrated CO2 gas can absorb more infrared radiation than dry air, but it is untrue to claim CO2 gas can make the warming faster inside the greenhouse all the time. Another type of experiments is based on real-time imaging of infrared radiation by using a high-end infrared camera.
I can show you how carbon dioxide affects Earth's climate using this heat-sensitive or infrared camera, which is purring away here. A candle, this glass tube, which is hooked up to this rather large canister of carbon dioxide gas. Now watch what happens when I turn on the carbon dioxide. Just keep your eye on the flame. The gas is invisible, so you don't see it fill in the tube. But as it comes in, you should see the candle start to disappear. There it goes. Look at that. What's happening is that the carbon dioxide in the tube is effectively trapping the heat. The candle's warmth no longer reaches the camera. Instead, it's absorbed by the carbon dioxide inside the tube.
That's right, but he didn't tell us at what wavelength does this CO2 absorption occur. This is an important question, as I discussed before, because the CO2 gas in the atmosphere only absorbs far infrared radiation from the Earth's surface at wavelengths 15 microns with a narrow bandwidth. This is a temperature distribution of a candle flame together with the typical spectra of the flame. By comparing with the CO2 absorption spectra here, it is clear that all of the CO2 absorption peaks could be observed using the flame, especially the strongest one near the wavelength 4.3 micron. So, unless the camera could selectively detect CO2 absorption near 15 micron, this experiment provides no direct evidence for the hypothetical global warming due to CO2. The following experiment was also based on using an infrared camera, but notice the source was different.
It is a little like throwing this towel over this heating pad. The towel interrupts the flow of heat, trapping the energy near the surface of the pad.
Yes, indeed. The towel can slow down the heat transfer in space and keep the surface warm. But the question is whether or not the towel could make the hot pad even warmer. They are obliged to answer this question because this video was endorsed by a high-profile institution of theoretical physics.
This heating pad emits infrared wavelengths and will simulate our planet's surface. We've sealed the ends of each cylinder with thin plastic wrap because glass itself blocks infrared radiation, but the thin plastic doesn't.
Wait a moment. This implies all of the experiments using glass bottles or flasks are invalid because the infrared radiation can be noticeably blocked by the glass.
We'll start with a cylinder filled with nitrogen gas and place it between the infrared camera and the heating pad. Looking down through the cylinder, we notice that the infrared energy passes right through nitrogen without being absorbed. If we try the cylinder filled with oxygen gas, we get a similar result. But carbon dioxide is a different story. Notice how the image in the infrared camera becomes much cooler. This reveals that the carbon dioxide is absorbing some of the infrared energy given off by the heating pad before it can reach the camera.
Yes, that's true, but nothing new. Certain amount of infrared energy can be absorbed by CO2, as first observed by the Irish physicist John Tyndall in 1860. So do other gases. Notice, as the source temperature increases, a stronger CO2 absorption band near 4.3 micron could be detected. This seems the case in this experiment. Nowadays, an infrared camera can be made to selectively detect the radiation at a particular wavelength, such as this newly designed bispectral camera, which can be especially used to detect CO2 absorption at 4.3 micron. Here, the spectra of typical light sources are shown. By comparing with the CO2 absorption spectra, we can categorically make our judgment on those claims based on an infrared source they used, such as the lamp used by the science guy, Bill Nye.
It's not only chemists who like the periodic table. I hear you carry one around.
I do carry one, yes, sir.
Show me.
You never know. And I seem to use it a lot.
Let's see.
It's a small one.
So I'm going to give you a test. What is under nitrogen in the periodic table?
Nitrogen is 7.
Yes.
I have to think a second.
Under
nitrogen.
No, you're wrong.
Okay.
Take two identical bottles and set them side by side. Put a thermometer in each bottle and seal them. Then run a hose from a source of CO2 into one of the bottles. Shine two heat lamps of equal intensity at equal distance onto each one.
Because glass itself blocks infrared radiation.
Within minutes, you will see the temperature of the bottle with the carbon dioxide in it rising faster and higher.
On the earth or something like that. And this one has a rubber cap, a rubber stopper, and this one does not. The rubber stopper represents an atmosphere.
The bottles are like our atmosphere. The lamps are like our sun.
I ask us all, is that really reasonable?
As said by other amateurs, Mr. Nye mistakenly referred the sun as the source of infrared absorption by carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Anyhow, this is just one of his shows rather than a real experiment. In passing, as the lamp was visible and the jar with the CO2 was ajar, making thermal convection possible, so it could be argued that the temperature in the sealed jar without CO2 should increase faster, contrary to his claim. Think about it. By the way, I tried to browse the NOAA website for the first experiment, but it seems too late. It has gone with the wind.
We have to reduce emissions urgently and take action to tackle the carbon already in the atmosphere.
Thank you for watching. See you next time.